Hello. In this session, I will present you the SBSFU homework part and then the first hands-on that is the continuation of this first homework. So let's go. So the purpose of this homework is to prepare your environment to be ready for the workshop hands-on related to SBSFU. So we detail the building of the SBSFU, and also we will flash the Nucleo L476 target to check everything is working fine. So here is the environment you should have installed following the installation procedure provided. So here you have the home directory, I would say, directly on C drive, STM32 Secure Workshop, a documentation folder where you have all the slides, and L4 directory, and followed also directories for the following of the workshop. You have finished projects that you can look at after. You have the scripts you will see, and then the SBSFU. So let me put it in the pointer here. The SBSFU 2.4.0 structure. We have the drivers, middlewares, and all the projects, including all the boards supported. So here is the beginning, and we will use the Nucleo L476RG, and we will find the SBSFU here with a user app, which is an example application. And so we have three projects: SBSFU, SE Corbin, and user app. The linker command is, as its name says, command files for linking the projects. First thing is to import the project in CubeIDE. So first we will start the CubeIDE. So I'm launching CubeIDE 1.4.0. Here it is. Here. So by default you should go to this to show you this workspace, but you can put it wherever you want. So I launch using this workspace. It takes a few seconds to start. Here it is. So this is the default view. We click here and there is no project at all. And the first thing to do is to open project from file system. Here it is, directory. Then let's go to our workshop and in L4 STM32 cube projects L476 application, two images. This is our project. So this is a two image project. We'll see later what it means. Select the folder. So CubeIDE detects three projects. We need to remove this one. And that's okay. You can finish. So CubeIDE will import the three projects. And let's go back to the slides. So here is what we just done. And then next thing is to build the three projects. You need first to build the SE Corbin, SBSFU, and user app. So start from SE Corbin. Click here. So launching the build, I will raise the. So it's building. Here it is. So we have our first SE Corbin build, and we can check rapidly if it is the same as expected with the size of the binary generated. So here we generated a binary AC Corbin. Then we can launch the building of SBSFU. This will take a bit more time because it is a bit bigger. So you can, while it is compiling, you can look into the directories. You have the application directory where are the source code. In the core, you have the main .c and usual files at HLMSP and interrupts. The whole SBSFU is in here in two directories, application and target. The target is contains all the files that need to be adapted when you change the target, mainly, and the application is mostly something that doesn't change depending on the target. So you have all these files compiled and also a lot of HL that are compiled. You can see here. Okay. And also one important thing is the use of some files inside middleware for the interface with the secure engine here. And then once this one is finished, we will build the user application. So that has also a similar structure. So let's wait for the end of this one. Okay, this is built. It took 2 minutes. We have 59578, 59578. We have the same build here. Then let's go back and build the user application. So user application, you have an application that goes with the main file, and you will see what it is doing. It's displaying a menu that gives you access to some features. The main feature you have access is the ability to make an update. And let's see this later. So here we are compiling the application and we should have something with 21, the text part 21632. I pause a little. Oh no, it's finished. 21632. Okay. And then you see at the end there is something that is done automatically, that is a post build, which is a script that is building automatically some binary files that will be used for downloading. So let's see. Next slide. So let's go to this binary files that we have just built. So I will look in the Explorer. So let's go to L4, go back to SBSFU, in the projects, Nucleo L476, application, two images, and two images, user app, binary. Then you see the two binaries that are built. The first one is a concatenation of the three binaries we have built, the SC Corbin, the SBSFU, and the user application that is ready to be flashed on the target. The user app.sfb is the update file of the user application. So it is the same file, but in an update format. So before flashing, what you will need for next hands-on is to update the ST-Link. So please use the the menu here, help ST-Link upgrade. Oops, it is here. And you just need to click on open in update mode and see if you have if you need to upgrade. Here I will make an upgrade with the same version, but it works obviously if you have an older version. So this upgrade is needed to update the firmware of the ST-Link embedded on the Nucleo. So it's successful, you can close it, and that's it. That's just what we did, we've done. Now you need to open an Explorer on the scripts that you will we use during the hands-on. So I've prepared a window for that. Here it is. So now you have connected already your target if you have done the ST-Link upgrade. And be careful, no, to be sure no other board should be connected. And then launch Start TerraTerm. So from the script, Start TerraTerm, it will automatically detect the COM port you are using. Here I'm using COM60. And nothing happens, obviously, there is no code executing on the target. Then prepare the target, launch a reset L4 target script. Let's launch it. Reset. So this script basically is executing RDP regression. So sets the RDP level 0 and also deactivates the write protections. So once this is done, your board is ready to be flashed. So now you could have an issue with a previous script that is using STM32 Cube Programmer if you didn't install it in the default directory. So in that case, you need to update this setenv.bat file to match the directory location you are using. Then download the SBSFU, so use the script 01. So let's download it. So you see we are downloading the file that we have generated here. So that is 55.8 size. So this is the file we are downloading. So you can, once it's done, you can press here. And if you, let's follow the slides. If you go to the terminal, you have this message, which is normal. So this message means that you have activated RDP level 1 and you need to do a power on reset to be able to start the board. So let's do it. I unplug my USB and plug it again. And I should have something displayed on my screen, so nothing display. If I press a space, I can see that something comes. If I press reset, I can see all the startup. The reason we didn't see anything at the beginning is that the USB enumeration was too long and the trace wasn't displayed, was already finished when the enumeration finished. So you can just press reset. And also you have in the slides something you can sometimes have on the screen, some strange characters. In that case, you just reset the terminal like this. So here, it comes back to the good condition. So here are the traces after reset. So we can compare the two. Here we have our trace here and what are on the slides. So if you have the same traces, that's okay. You're done with this homework. So here, let's go to the hands-on. We have finished the homework. If you have any issue, you can still go to this address, and you have a lot of FAQ and tips and tricks to be able to solve the issues you can face. So let's go to the next hands-on, which is building the SBSFU. So starting from what we've just done, we have built the SBSFU and executed on target. Then we will check the secure boot, what it is doing, and we will generate a version 2 of the application and update it in the target. So restarting from our configuration, we've just finished the homework, so we should be in the right condition. So first, to explain you what happened in the traces, the first trace you have after SBSFU boot is this one, where SBSFU is checking the security environment. So if all the option bytes are correctly set, especially. And then it's initializing the secure engine, and then check the status after reset, where you can display the errors that you had on the previously. We will see how it works. Then check new firmware to download. This is a first check using the local loader of the SBSFU to check if there is a download request. And then check user firmware status, that is checking if there is something in the active slot and if there is something in the download slot. Here, nothing in the download slot, but something in active slot. It is checking the firmware signature of this active slot. So we will see during this workshop how this firmware signature is actually done. And once the signature is checked, we can execute the user firmware. So at this point, the SBSFU has made a complete check of the application that will be launched. We are sure that the application is genuine and was not corrupted. That's the purpose of the secure boot. Then we have our application that displays some menus, interactive menus. So this is the quick view on the traces. So test protection menu, let's play with this menu. So I'm coming back to our console and press 2, and we have this menu where we check the protection. So the firewall is the enclave that protects the secure engine. So here we try to directly access to the firewall from the user application. So I press 2. And what happens? The access is detected here, and automatically a reset is performed. And then the SBSFU is restarting and can check there was a firewall reset. So you can add your own action if you detect, for example, a firewall reset. Now there is just the action is only to display a trace, but you can do whatever you want. And then we will start. So test another protection, for example, the independent watchdog. I press 6. So what happens is entering a while loop and waiting that the watchdog is just triggering. So here, after some time, watchdog has triggered and it is detected as a watchdog. So this is what you can do with this menu. Next menu, test SE user code. So SE means secure engine. This menu allows the calling an API in the secure engine. So the secure engine provides a secure API, and SBSFU provides just one example of API. So just try it, press 3, and then we are in a configuration with where we have only one active slot. So press 1 with for active slot 1, and then we get two information coming from the secure engine: the active firmware version and the active firmware size. Next slide. So here is just what we've displayed. Oops, sorry. So a note about active slots. Active slot is where active user firmware is located, by opposition with download slot, where the new version of the firmware is downloaded. So you have active and download. With the latest SBSFU 2.4, we have now 3 possible active slots and 3 possible download slots. But we can have a configuration with 3 active slots and only 1 download slot. So the download slot will be able to download one update for one of the 3 active slots. So the download slot must be at least the maximum size of the 3 active slots. And the main purpose of introducing these multiple active slots is the support of multiple core chips that have independent firmwares. So SBSFU in a nutshell, we have seen rapidly the SBSFU directory structure, how to build it in the adequate order. We have seen the two files that are generated, one which is the big file including all the binaries, and the second one which is just the update. The SBSFU and the application then are loaded at the same time on the target with this big file. We have seen that SBSFU is activating the secure protection. We didn't activate them. You have seen that RDP level 1 was set automatically. This was done by the SBSFU. Also, you have seen by the traces that it is checking the user application authenticity and that it is launching the application after this check. Also, you have seen what the default user application we provide that is doing some protection check, a call to Secure Engine API, and also the first one that we didn't address yet, the update. So let's see how this update is working. So this is done by the first menu. So this update is managed inside the application. The menu is inside the application, and the code to transfer the update is inside the application. So we use the Ymodem protocol to transfer this, to be able to have a protocol that makes sure that the transfer is going well. This protocol enables writing each chunk of the new firmware in the download slot. And at the end, the application, once it has downloaded the whole update, It should reset the chip to activate the SBSFU, and then SBSFU will detect the new firmware and will install it. So let's see how it works. We have the TeraTerm that is managing the Wi modem protocol, or SBSFU, the user application that is in a slot. It's slot one active, and slot one update. Sorry, so it's one here. So this application contains a loader, what we call a loader. A loader is just something that is able to communicate here and able to flash the content of what it received. So it transfers the firmware that we generated, userapp.sfb. Once it's transferred, it resets to give back the hand to the secure boot. So after reset, the SBSFU is executed. SBSFU is checking the is detecting a new firmware, and once it's detecting the new firmware, it is checking this new firmware using authentication, and it installs the new firmware once it has been authenticated by swapping the two slots. And once the swap is done, a new authentication is done to make sure everything is was done correctly. So let's do it and prepare the update image. So the just to be sure that we have updated the image, we will change something in the code. So go in the main.c in the application and change user app ID to B. So I will launch here, go to user and main.c. In main.c, here I find user app ID at line 51 and replace it by B. Control S to save the file. And the second thing to do is to change the user, the version of the firmware. So to change it, click on user app, right click, properties, and C++ build here, settings, and build steps. You click here, and at the end you see one and one. The first one is meaning slot one, so active slot one, and here it means version one, so we'll change to version two. Oops. Then rebuild this new version, so we'll go a bit here, and you will see that it will launch a post build with version 2 here. Here it is. So post build is generating version 2, and so now our version 2, we can download it. So if we come back to so here you can see that it was not finished. So just here, we have the new the two new files that were just generated. So let's do the update. So first, come back to the console. So I come back to the top menu and press one. So first, what it is doing, it is erasing the downloads download area, so the download slot one, and waiting for data through Wi modem protocol. To do this, you just need to access to file, transfer, Wi modem send. So this is a protocol supported by TeraTerm. You press send, it will open automatically, normally in the good directory. Let's check it. Here we are on Windows Secure L4 cube project application to image, and so on. So we are in the code directory. Just select user app.sfb and it will transfer the user app. It's quite fast, it's 22k bytes. So here what's happening is that it has detected a new firmware in slot download one, and it is image preparation consists in decrypting the firmware in slot one, and then it is swapping. Then I come back. It is swapping the two images. Once the swap has been done, it is resetting, and there is no more download. It is detecting the new firmware and verifying. And then we have our user application B. We can check using the menu 3, test user code with still slot 1. And we have our version 2 that we just put. So this is what's in the following slides. Select the update, download, and then we have the full update done. And our user app B and the version 2. So in conclusion, as you could see, it's the first build is very simple, and the first, even the first update is straightforward. SBSFU well, is a secure bootloader that checks integrity, authenticity of the application. That's its main purpose. Also, for the update, DSBSFU is checking the integrity and authenticity at each update step to make it really secure. And also, we could see that we use a Ymodem protocol for transferring, but this is provided as an example. You just, if you want to use something else, you just need to adapt the transfer protocol. So that's it for this first hands-on. Thank you.